In times past, where healthcare knowledge and practices were not as advanced as they are today, our elders had popular beliefs and practices in the care of the newborn, which they passed down to us and still practice today. However, have we assessed the advantages and disadvantages of these popular beliefs and practices, and how they affect the overall health of the newborn? Join us today as we discuss the pros and cons of popular beliefs and practices in the care of the newborn, right here on One on One with Dr. B. Hello everyone, welcome again to another session of One on One with Dr. B. I'm Sika.
I'm Emma.
And in today's session, we'll be discussing the pros and cons of popular beliefs concerning the care of a newborn. So enjoy as we discuss. We are here with Dr. Y. Henry. Welcome, Dr. Y.
Thank you very much. And thanks for having me once again.
Okay. So we're going to go straight into it. We asked a few of the mothers we know about some of the popular beliefs that they practice, that they probably learned from their mothers or from family. And we just want to discuss them. What are the advantages? What are the disadvantages? So I'll start with the first one. It says breast milk is watery in nature and does not satisfy the newborn. So introduce the newborn to corn and millet. Corn and millet porridge a few weeks after birth.
Okay, so that's an interesting one. Right, that's quite an interesting one. So this is what it is. This is quite a broad topic because then it would want us to go into the benefits of breast milk, especially in the later period, or even the first first 6 months of a child's life. Yes, it's good that breast milk is water. But it has its protein component, okay? And then what we are saying is that if you think that the breast milk is not what's right for the child at that age, and that your millet, right?
Yes, corn and millet.
Corn and millet, yes. Then why is it that most of the times, about 80% of those times, when you start giving those children those kind of other meals, then they either have constipation, or they will be passing stools, or they will not gain adequate weight as they are supposed to.
Okay.
It does happen. You see, the unfortunate aspect about this whole beliefs is that people in their small corner are the ones who have the beliefs. They don't consider the generality of people. They don't consider the fact that there is probably somebody who sees on average 60 people coming to him with complaints about some of these things. Okay, for what I said, I can tell the authority that certainly these options in the first days of life are not the best.
Okay.
Because we've seen countless occasions where that's rather led to the detriment of the children. Now let's go into the benefits of the breast milk itself. One, the breast milk has 70% of itself being water, and then the other percentage being protein or other nutrients. The breast milk is of a natural source. It's coming from a human being. Okay, so what you are expecting is that because it's coming from a human being, the likelihood that a fellow human being is going to digest it better, for it to do the function that it's supposed to do in the same human being, is higher. So obviously, by so doing, what we are saying is that it's not likely going to lead to constipation.
Okay.
It's not likely going to lead to the child passing sensitive to, if everything is well with the child. Sometimes what people seem to forget is that though the child might be on exclusive breastfeeding, there are other disease conditions that can strike the child. That is there. But if you are talking of the benefit of breast milk itself, it provides the best of, if you want, immunity. But we sometimes say that the best gift that you can give to your child in the first 6 months of life is the breast milk and nothing else, because of the enormity of its advantages. He protects them right then at the neonatal period. He doesn't give way for you to go out and introduce organisms when you are preparing those other meals. And then, by and large, it prevents the child from having some kind of disease when the children are growing.
Okay.
The advantage also is that it is believed that breast milk that or breastfed children tend to be a bit more calmer, they are smarter, and they don't end up in prisons. And they don't also get some kinds of chronic diseases like diabetes and hypertension when they are growing. So all the studies have gone on, massive studies have gone on. And so it is very difficult for some of us to want to subscribe to the parent that asks that, you know, after all, breast milk is light and things like that. No, it's not about the light, it's light enough and good enough for the intestines and stomach of the child to harbor it and allow the child to get the best of immunity.
Okay, so there's another question. I don't know what the question or the person was just. The person said newborns need to be introduced to different tastes, so they give them pepper and salt in order for them to know the difference.
That's an interesting one. So this is what happens. So it's in a way trying to say that you shouldn't do exclusive, isn't it?
Yeah.
Why is anybody trying to think that God, if this world is modeling, to want to add salt or those kind of taste to the breast milk? Are you getting it?
Yeah.
So the breast milk is holistic for that age group. It is so holistic for that age group that anything else that you are introducing, there's a back for that. And in most cases, they turn around to harm their children.
Mm-hmm.
How many of us haven't we seen instances where a child will be on exclusive breastfeeding for, let's say, 3 months, the child is doing well, everything is doing nice, skin, everything. Then once you start introducing other meals, formulas, or cocoa, some will say, oh, cocoa milk, we've lightened them. Well, no, all those things, the stomach is not ready. And so then the stomach, in a way of reacting back, can give you those reactions, can give you those vomiting, can let the child poo-poo excessively. And so there is no way anybody can say that newborns are supposed to taste various types of taste and things like that. It's supposed to be exclusively breastfed. Because see, if you do those other things, because you are just an individual, maybe you may go scot-free, but come and ask people who have seen children who have been subjected to some kind of acts, and they will tell you what the real story is. That
okay, so another one says that newborns have to be kept indoors for several weeks after they are born to protect them from evil eyes.
Well, of course, you know, people are spiritual, people have their beliefs, there is science, okay? So from what I see, it will be very difficult for you to convince me about the evil eye aspect, all right? Yes, for some people, they do that because they believe that the child has to be kept in an environment where people may not have access to their child. Of course, excessive touching of the child, handling of the child, so that people not coming in and not washing their hands can really be detrimental to the child. But to say that you are doing so because you want to take away evil eyes, maybe that's what they are looking at. Maybe they consider people coming to touch the child and pass on infection to the child as evil eyes. And so be it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get it?
Yeah.
And that's why sometimes, you know, these things have been generational. And so probably our great grandfathers and mothers had in mind that a child has to be protected from this kind of touching by everybody every now and then. Especially the immune system is down when they are little.
Yeah.
So you need to protect them in that line.
Mm-hmm.
But the flip side of that is that, especially for the first time mothers, if you keep your child enclosed in a setting, where there isn't much illumination, the danger is that the color of the child might be changing, what we call the later jaundice, and you might not be able to detect. In which case, we've seen instances where they come with basically connectors. That's the worst form of later jaundice, where the bilirubin level may have even gotten to the brain of the child, and some even lead to death or permanent disability, you know, into life. Yes, those things are there, where if you don't have adequate illumination, those things can happen. So as we are trying to prevent them from the so-called evil eye, that is avoiding coming in contact with plenty of people and touching them and passing on infection to them, we should be mindful of the fact that if we don't observe their colors in them, especially the first 7 days of life, can be detrimental to the child's life.
There's another one. Newborns need to have their hair smoothed with warm water in order to keep their hair a nice shape.
Alright. So, what I would ask is, since when did we become sculptors or whatever that, since when did we know better than God? Alright. Alright. Unfortunately, some of those things have been generational, and it's difficult to change. But I realize that the up and coming new mothers have access to information.
Okay.
They are reading a lot more. And so that act, I can tell you, authority, has been very much relegated to the background. As we speak, a lot of new mothers are not allowing, you know, the old timers, asking the grandmothers to be doing those things to their children, because they've read and they realize that some of the information in there sounds written, the reason. Why? Because you don't need those things for the child to, I mean, they don't have any benefits. On the contrary, when the newborn is born, the scalp, all right, is very fragile, it's still very fragile. And just believe that the scalp is the brain matter. And so if you keep subjecting that a fragile skin to hot water, some of the waters can be very hot and moldy and what have you, all in dangers of trying to get the best of shape. Well, another thing is that you might be damaging the neurons of the child. Okay, and so studies have shown that's what's likely happens. And so even some people are being duped by the fact that, well, that's why, you know, people of our descent are not able to do inventions. All right. And so let's it doesn't benefit them in any way. And as I said, I'm really glad that nowadays most mothers are shy away from that, and they actually prevent the grandmothers to do so. Because thankfully nowadays most mothers, grandmothers also come to their visits, and so they are able to understand the explanations that are given.
The final one is, mothers use their fingers to clean the teeth and tongues of the newborn.
Yeah, what?
Their finger to clean the teeth and the tongue of the newborn, since they can't brush the child's teeth.
So, but the point is that if a child is a newborn, it presumed, under the God, it has a what called a false tooth, which may appear as a single tooth, but they don't have teeth. And for me, it sounds to reason that the only time you may want to brush a child's teeth is when the child has their teeth. You get it?
Yeah.
And it's only when the child has teeth that other products may get stuck in there for you to want to brush.
Mm-hmm.
So if the child has not got a teeth, why would you want to suggest that actions that are meant for people who are supposed to have teeth and brush them?
Mm-hmm.
And so some will say, oh, the tongue has become white.
Mm-hmm.
But the tongue has become white because of the breastfeeding that you are doing.
Mm-hmm.
So it still doesn't justify why you want to do put all manner of people put tomatoes and all manner of things into the mouth of their children.
You want to prevent mouth odor.
Yes. Oh. And all those things rather tend to harm the children, because some of the children may react to those tomatoes and other products that they use. Mm-hmm. Alright. And I say that the only time a child will require for oral treatment care is when they start appearing.
Okay.
Because God is always on as Peter saliva. Mm-hmm. And the saliva is supposed to function as a way of keeping the oral mucosa clean.
Mm-hmm.
So there is no need for us to use those kind of parts in the later period. It's not, necessary.
So situations where they use glycerin on the tongue, you know, they put in towel that clean to clean the tongue in units or in babies of about eight to ten months, they want to use I think it's good. I have to find out. It's like a solution they put in the towel and then they just use to clean the mouth, the tongue of the baby. So that is also
not something. So if at any point the age group that you mentioned, some of the children may have teeth already.
Mm-hmm.
In which case, yeah, then some of those acts. Mm-hmm. And even that one, we'll still recommend the type of brush 0 to 12, 0-1 to 12 months. And then the paste 0 to 12 months. Because those ones have the textures of the paste, the brush, as such that it may not cause any harm. And then the fluoride in those age groups may also not cause harm, even if the child swallows those fluorides. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
So yes, when they get to a point where there is a teeth, then the justification is that it can be done.
Okay. All right. This has been a very interesting session. I hope you've learned something and some of your beliefs or practices have been adjusted. You make room to adjust some of these beliefs and practices. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you in our next video.